So you've created an awesome procedural material, like this one for my procedural texturing course, but now you actually want to use it in your work. If you're working only within Blender, you might be able to get away with just rendering it as is. But with a complex material, this can be slow as the whole shader needs to be evaluated many times during the rendering process. On the other hand, if you're taking your material to another program, like a game engine, rendering the material as is isn't even an option. Both of these issues can be solved by baking the material into image textures. When you think about baking, maybe baking lighting comes to mind. We're not doing quite the same. We don't want to evaluate any scene lighting. We'll just be baking the results of some of our own shader computations and putting them into image textures. That means that in the end, the render engine is still responsible for all the lighting and everything, so the lighting stays dynamic. The only difference is that now instead of doing a whole bunch of computations, the render engine can just look up values in an image texture. So the trade-off is that our procedural material gets frozen, losing the ability to animate parameters, and the texture has a fixed resolution, losing the almost infinite scalability of procedural textures. To start baking, we first need a few preparatory steps. First, we need to make sure that our object has proper UVs. The image textures will be mapped onto those UVs. In this case, we just have a plane, which already has default UVs, but if you have some more complicated object, make sure to unwrap it first. Also note that whichever UVs are selected in the UV panel will be used for baking, so if you have multiple UV maps, make sure to select the right one. The next thing we need is an image to bake to, so let's click the New button. For the first texture, let's call it diffuse color, or you could call it albedo, depending on your naming conventions. Then we can set the resolution of the texture we want. In this case, since the plane UVs take up the whole UV space, I'll be using the same aspect ratio of 2 to 1 as the plane, so that the texture resolution is the same in both directions. So let's say 2000 by 1000, but this will vary depending on your needs. We won't need an alpha channel for any of our maps, so we can uncheck that. Now, probably the most important setting for our new image is whether or not we want it to be 32-bit. If we don't check this, it will create an 8-bit buffer. This might be fine for some color data, and can be a reasonable choice if you're exporting to game engines. But for anything else, it's generally a bad idea, especially with things like displacement, which can have negative values, as those will be clamped to 0 if you bake to an 8-bit image. So unless you have a very good reason not to use a 32-bit image, it's best to always enable it. For use within Blender, I always use 32-bit images for everything, including colors, as it makes sure that everything is properly represented and there is no data loss, avoiding issues like color banding. Now, with our image set up, we need to tell Blender that we want to bake to this image. For this, we need to add an image texture node to our material and select our target image. This node doesn't need to be connected to anything, but it does need to be the active node, as that's how we specify which image texture we want to bake to. We also need to make sure that the object itself is active and selected. If we head over to the Render Properties tab and make sure that our render engine is set to Cycles, we can find the Baking panel. Here we can select what we want to bake. By default, it's set to Combined, which will bake everything into one image, including the color and all the lighting passes. The result is basically an image that represents how the surface looks in a given environment. There are also several other modes that bake different lighting passes and some limited utility passes like roughness. If your whole shader is represented with only principled or diffuse shaders, you can bake the color by selecting diffuse mode and then unchecking direct and indirect lighting, leaving only the surface color. You can also bake the roughness by selecting roughness mode, but that's about it. All the other information can't be baked directly. This won't do for us. We have a more complex shader which includes a velvet component, and we want to have a map of everything that we plug into any of the shader nodes so that we can have a completely identical result after baking. Luckily, there is a simple way to bake any arbitrary value from the tree. If we connect a node to the cycle's material output, it gets rendered through an emission shader, so the value is just being output directly to the render result. This is perfect for us as there is a baking mode that enables us to bake the emitted values. It's conveniently labeled emit. This allows us to bake the output of any node, except for shader nodes. And this is exactly what we want, to be able to reconstruct the shader exactly from the baked maps. The last setting that we need to pay attention to is the amount of render samples. This will determine the amount of samples in the baking process as well. Since we aren't baking any lighting, we really don't need many samples, as the emission has no noise at all. The samples are just for anti-aliasing in this case, so something like 16 is plenty, but in the interest of speed, in this quick demo, I'll just set it down to 4. So let's start baking. For the first texture, which we named diffuse color, let's accordingly connect the color which we're feeding to the principled shader. To recap, let's make sure that our target image texture is selected, as well as our object and the desired UV map. Then, with our bake mode set to emit, we can finally press bake. After a bit, we'll see the result appear in the image editor. Then let's make sure to save or pack the image, otherwise once we close our Blender session, the result is lost, though Blender will show as a reminder when exiting if we forget to save. For the image format, if you're baking 32-bit images, as we are here, I highly recommend using EXR. This is the best format to preserve all the data, as it supports 32-bit depth and will preserve the negative values. If you're working with 8-bit color data, a format like TIFF should work well, but as I said before, 32-bit is definitely preferable, and in that case, EXR is the way to go. You can always select 16-bit half float if you need to save space. Now let's repeat the process for the other shader parameters. If we want to do the roughness next, we just need to create another image, then connect the roughness map to the output, and don't forget to update the image texture node. We could change the image in this same node, or we can just add a new one, since we'll need to input the resulting images into the material later anyway. Then, with the new node active and set to the proper image texture, we can press bake again. Then it's just a matter of repeating this for the remaining parameters. So that would be the height map, the moss mask, and the moss color. So having baked all the parameters, we can now replace practically the whole node tree with just a few image textures. So that we don't mess up our existing setup, let's just duplicate the final bit of our node tree with the shader nodes. This also allows us to easily have access to the original tree in case we need to bake again. Alternatively, we could put the new setup into a whole new material, but let's just keep everything here for now. Then all we have left to do is connect all the baked maps to the corresponding parameters. This is one of the few cases where plugging a color into a value socket is okay, since all the channels have the same value and therefore the computed luminance is the same as the average of the channels, which is also the same as each individual channel. Now if we look at the result, it behaves identically to the fully procedural version. The only differences are that it renders much faster, and if we zoom in, we see that we don't have all the small details, as we're limited by the texture resolution. The difference is especially noticeable if we bump up the subdivisions. This is really all there is to baking any parameters from the tree. With this, you can bake all your procedural textures to accelerate your renders or to port them over to other software. But now, let's get to some extra tips. Earlier, I mentioned how baking means that we lose the ability to animate our textures, but there is actually a way to get almost the best of both worlds. Often, we don't need to animate parameters throughout the whole tree, so say we have a big, heavy part of the tree that doesn't require animation. Well, in that case, we can bake the result of just that part and plug it into the rest of the tree. There is no reason why we need to limit ourselves to baking just the final values that get plugged into the shader nodes. We can just as well bake any value in the middle of the tree to accelerate all the computations before that point. But I'll leave that for you to experiment with. Another cool thing that we can do with baked textures is actual displacement in Eevee. Even though Eevee doesn't support displacement natively, there's nothing stopping us from feeding it an already displaced mesh. The trick here is that the displacement modifier works exactly like the displacement node. And while we can't feed procedural textures directly into the displacement modifier, we can feed it image textures. So let's add a displacement modifier and add a new texture slot. Then, opening the texture parameters, we can select our displacement map. We only need to change two settings here. Firstly, under the mapping panel, we need to change the extension from repeat to extend. This is important to avoid interpolation artifacts at the edges. And the other setting is under the colors panel, where we need to disable clamp so that our negative values are preserved. Now going back to the modifier settings, let's set the coordinates to UV and select our UV map. We should keep the direction set to normal, as that's what the displacement node does, and the rest of the parameters can just be copied from the displacement node. That's just the strength and mid-level. With these settings all matching, the results should be completely identical. The cool thing about using the modifier is that we can already see the result in the viewport, and if we switch to Eevee now, we get the wall in all its full displaced glory, just like in Cycles. Note that for this trick, we only really needed to bake the displacement map. The shader itself could still be procedural, though baked textures will definitely render faster. Another useful tip is that if you're baking several single values, you can save some space and time by combining several maps into a single texture. When baking color or vector data, we need all three color channels of the texture to store them, but with single values, we're storing a lot of redundant information. If we look at one of the single value maps, like the displacement map, and separate the channels with a separate RGB node, we can see that we're storing exactly the same data three times. Instead, we can use a combine RGB node and plug in three values that we want to bake at once. Here, conveniently, we have exactly three value maps to bake: the roughness, depth, and moss mask. With them combined, we can add a new image and name it accordingly. Now it's just a matter of configuring another image texture node and baking this out. Then we have a single texture that contains a different map in each of the three channels, and we can get them back with a separate RGB node. This technique is very common in games to save space, but even in a VFX project, it can make a significant difference. And it's not just about space, because you also save baking time by avoiding the many repeated computations of baking the three maps individually. Lastly, it's good to keep in mind that you're not limited to baking out only a single version of the texture maps. We can bake out different versions of the maps for different needs. For instance, let's say we want a close-up of this wall. In that case, we need more resolution for all the small details. But instead of making a gigantic texture, which would take a long time to bake and take up a huge amount of space, we can bake out just the part that we need. All we need to do is edit the UVs. So if we duplicate the UV map and set this as the default for rendering as well, then we can just pop into the UV editor and scale the UVs so that the texture covers just the part of the wall that is needed for the shot. Now we can bake all the maps onto these new UVs. Even though the image textures are the same size, this gives us a much higher resolution for just that part, at the cost of not having the proper texture for the rest of the wall. This can be worth the trouble if we have long shots to render, as the saved render time will far outweigh the bit of extra time it takes to bake the additional maps. And that's it. With these tips and techniques, you should be able to bake all your procedural textures for many different use cases that you might encounter.